you manage your stress and how you manage your time. You need to be smart when it comes to making your relationships work. You need to be smart when it comes to planning for your retirement. That's the wisdom of this world. But what's it really benefit me if I'm not really sure why I'm here or what my purpose is, who I am, who God is, what my relationship with Him is all about, or what He's done for me? Apart from that, all of that other wisdom is meaningless. And yet we love that stuff. We just eat it up like it's the wisdom that really matters. So how much do we need today for God to say, no, come to me and get the wisdom you really need? And be made wise through faith in Jesus Christ. Which is exactly what God is doing for us again today. Let's begin our worship with a gathering rite on the precious Word of God, that's on page 2 in our service folder. We'll stay seated for the first part, and I'll motion to you and announce to you when it is time for us to stand before the confession of sins. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray.
believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The scriptures testify about Jesus, lived a perfect life for you, died on the cross to pay for all of your sins, and rose again to assure you of your salvation. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Yeah. Does he tell you especially, trust that Jesus took away all of your sins, all of the foolish ways we live, where we mess it all up? Does he tell us to believe that all this is forgiven in Jesus so we can be happy? No. Does he tell us he's going to take us to heaven when we're loved by life? Yeah. So here's what I want you to do. Because you have such a wonderful God who loves you, remember the next time you see a can over here, that there's a right way to use it and a wrong way to use it. And remember, you have a right way to live and a wrong way. And you live the right way because Jesus is your Savior and your friend. Do it for him because he loves you so much. You can go back to Jesus. Thank you. Our first lesson for today is our Old Testament lesson from Proverbs chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. In this lesson, wisdom is calling out to simple-minded and senseless people. So if you pretty much have life figured out and you feel you don't really need God's guidance, this Old Testament lesson probably isn't one you're going to need to listen to. So you can stop your ears at this point. But if, on the other hand, you know you've proven with your sinful thinking and living for your entire life how foolish you really are, then listen carefully to the message of wisdom because it is for you. And the message is one that lifts us up in the certainty of all that God has done for us in Christ our Savior. The wisdom God wants to give to sinful simpletons like us is pictured as this beautiful feast in our Old Testament lesson. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn out its seven pillars. She's prepared her meat and mixed her wine. She's also set her table. She has sent out her maids, and she calls from the highest point of the city, "Let all who are simple come in here," she says to those who lack judgment. "Come, eat my food and drink the wine I have mixed. Leave your simple ways, and you will live. Walk in the way of understanding." This is our Old Testament lesson. In our song for today, Psalm 119, which is found on page 111 at the front of our hymnals, we're going to sing about how wisdom is precious when we use it. So we'll be encouraged and encourage each other to live a life of wisdom that shows that we realize how precious the Word of God and our Savior is to us. We sing Psalm 119.
Oh, my.
that God's wisdom is always completely countercultural and it is always unconventional. The Apostle Paul says, be careful how you live. I live in a culture that says, live however you want. The Apostle Paul says, don't get drunk. College is about to start pretty soon. Do you think that's going to be the prevailing message? Or do you think that underage drinking and drunkenness is going to be glorified? The Apostle Paul says, go to church and encourage each other. In a culture like ours where church attendance is dwindling by the day, God's wisdom is always unconventional, countercultural, and counter my own desires. So when you're weighing, do I follow the wisdom of this world and my own sinful desires, or do I follow God's wisdom? May it be thanks for a Savior that leads you to live in a way that is true wisdom, as Paul encourages us. Be very careful, then, how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is our lesson. Alleluia. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Alleluia.
The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated, and we will continue with the singing of hymn 735, which is an insert in our bulletin, Speak, O Lord. This is a hymn from Christian Worship Supplement, so it may be a little bit unfamiliar to some of us. What I would encourage those who are a little better than the rest of us at sight reading music to do is to sing out a little bit more loudly to help the rest of us along as we sing hymn 735.
Why they might be called.
So when you see it's your mom calling, she probably just wants to see how your week is going, pick that up. If it's some unknown organization that's probably just calling you for a donation, you ignore that call. Wisdom's calling us today from our Old Testament lesson. We know why wisdom's calling. Wisdom has prepared this feast for us. It's the feast of God's own wisdom about life and why we're here and how to live it and who we are and where we're going and who God is and what our relationship with Him is all about and what He's done for us, especially for our salvation. It would be a no-brainer to say, I gotta get this call, I gotta pick this up. Except that I'm just sinful enough that often maybe I want to say, a little bit later maybe, or maybe it's just with half-hearted enthusiasm that I say, I suppose I better get that. Does that sound familiar? Well, may God Himself, through His Word today, open our hearts and change our perspective. So that whenever wisdom is calling, whenever God wants to share with us His wise and saving truth in Christ, we are eager to hear. Admitting that the call is always intended for me, and also appreciating what wisdom so desperately wants to tell me. All right, so wisdom calls out, but all of our simple, come in here. Wisdom calls out like that to those who lack judgment, we're told. So is wisdom really calling out to you? Because I'm thinking wisdom's calling out to unbelievers, right? They're clueless. They don't get it. They live in ignorance. They don't know anything about God. So wisdom's call is for all those unbelievers out there. For the people who practice those crazy primitive religions, like these Taoists I read about this week in Thailand, during one particular religious festival, they honor their ancestors and their gods by taking knives and shoving them from one cheek through the mouth cavity here and then through the other cheek. Or how about this spiritist tribe in Western Africa that worships their god this way? They take out some guy in their religion into the middle of the woods, deep into the forest, and they pray for the earth spirit, a demon, to enter and possess them. Or what about the residents of this tiny island in the Pacific called Bunlap, where in order to seek the blessing of your god, you build this rickety tall tower out of sticks, climb up it, and then you jump off head first with your ankles tied to a vine. Now here's the difference between a vine and a bungee cord. Vines don't give, so you stand a pretty good chance you're going to dislocate some joints or maybe you're going to break some bones when you do that. But that's how you get your God's blessing. Pretty foolish, huh? But is it just primitive religions that show the foolishness? Or is it highly educated, brilliant people in our world, like many scientists and physicists, who, recognizing that life is just a little too complex to have started by chance, have actually speculated this, that highly advanced aliens from another part of our solar system came to Earth and seeded life here, which isn't even an answer to the question of our origins, because it begs the question, where did these aliens come from? How is it that they exist? Well, what about the father of my vicar year who came in to tell me that his daughter would not be returning for a second year of youth confirmation class? And the reason he gave was he didn't want to pigeonhole his daughter in a certain faith. He wanted her to be free to choose her own path, he said, in whatever religion she wanted to be a part of. Do you think he'd apply that kind of thinking to his daughter's health or her finances? Do you think he would say, I want my daughter to choose her own path when it comes to her health, so I'm not going to guide her by ever talking to her about nutritious food, or about getting proper rest, or exercising properly. I'm never going to talk to her about how to balance a checkbook, how to use a credit card, or the power of compound interest. I'm going to let her figure out her own path when it comes to her health and finances. What parent would do that? What parent would be so foolish as to do that? There was a woman one time who told me when I said that adultery was wrong, that that was just my opinion and that was my interpretation of the Bible. I wonder if she would have the courage
to tell three sobbing children whose adulterous father had just abandoned them that adultery is not wrong. I'll bet you we can talk all morning about the crazy foolishness of unbelief out there in the world, and how wisdom's trying to reach all those people who are so stupid in their foolish, sinful unbelief. Except then we guess who really needs to hear this invitation from wisdom, which is me. I've got a very stupid, sinful nature, and I routinely show how foolish it really is. How about you? In the craziness of your sinful thinking, have you ever thought, I know that God says there are consequences to sin, but that's not going to happen to me. Nothing bad's going to happen. Until the house of cards fell down, until we have hurt others, and maybe did harm to ourselves, and dishonored God's name, and ruined maybe something good in our lives. How smart is that? Or have you ever thought of how foolish we can be and how we deal with the guilt of our sin? All of the ways we try to deal with our guilt that not only don't make sense, but clearly don't work. I'm going to deny that what I'm doing is wrong. I'll call God a liar. I'll call my conscience a liar. But I'm going to deny that this is really wrong. That's fine. Or what about blaming my sin on the circumstances in my life or other people, when in the end it was my decision? What about calling anybody who dares to confront me with my sin the really bad one, because they're making me feel guilty, even though the truth is, I am guilty? Or what about the way we offer to God these tiny little scraps of piety in other areas of our life? Like, that's going to make God say, oh, you really are a good person. I'll look past all the failure, the moral and spiritual failure, and I'll take a look at these little scraps and I'll conclude you're really good. How stupid can you be? Or what about this? We're struggling with some problems in our life. And I mean, day to day, the struggles go on, and sometimes we forget to bring them to an almighty God who can do anything to help us. Or sometimes, maybe the struggle in whatever area of life we're struggling is one where all we would need to do is turn to the Bible, to the one who's all-wise, who knows everything, and who shares us all this great wisdom to help us in life. And instead, we just keep muddling along day after day, not even turning to his word to ask the question, how would God guide me and strengthen me to deal with this? How foolish can you be? So when wisdom calls out to me, don't think wisdom's trying to get somebody's attention other than you. Swallow hard, admit your foolishness, and realize this is for me. Wisdom's calling out to the fool that is me, and be glad she is, because wisdom has some very important, comforting, encouraging things to say to a sinner like you. And appreciate what wisdom has to say, starting with this. Wisdom calls out to us, leave your simple ways. The worst sin a person can commit in our culture is to tell someone else their thinking and their behavior is wrong. We call that intolerance of our culture. But is it intolerance, or is it love? When a mother tells a toddler who's just hit his sister, that's wrong. Isn't it love for the little sister who gets hurt when she gets hit? Isn't it love for the person who just did the hitting, so they don't grow up thinking that the way you deal with things is by attacking other people? Or what about the teenage mom who tells her daughter not to mess around with drugs and not to blow off her homework? And when she does, she calls her on that. Is that being intolerant of her daughter's independence, or is it being loving to tell her, this is not the way you want to go through life. It's this harmful path. The man who tells his friend he's getting too friendly with the woman he works with because he doesn't want him to ruin his marriage, and tells the woman he works with that her out-of-control spending is going to lead to financial ruin, is that an act of mean-spirited intolerance for their chosen lifestyles, or is it love? What leads God to tell you and me, leave your simple ways? It's love. God doesn't want me in my own foolishness to hurt somebody else with my sin, to hurt myself, to dishonor him, to ruin something good in my life. And above all, he doesn't want this to happen to me. He says the waywardness of the simple will kill them. If I stay on the road of resistance to God's word, ends in eternal suffering and hell. God tells me so clearly. And because he loves me. He says, leave your simple ways and live instead of die. Live by trusting in the good news I have for you, we call the gospel. And the gospel is this good news. First of all, it's the good news that God loves you. Even though you look at yourself and you hate yourself and despise yourself because of your sin, that is not how God looks at you. Don't ever confuse that. He loves you with an unfailing love. That's the good news of the gospel. Your sins are all forgiven. That's the good news of the gospel. The shameful way you've used other people in your life, the shameful way you've neglected people you love, the cowardice you've showed when you didn't have the guts to do the right thing, the hypocrite you've proven yourself to be by what you do in private, nobody knows about but you, all of that's forgiven. It's like it's not even on the record. It's so completely forgiven. And because it's so totally forgiven, God can give you this good news, that you're not going to pay for your sins in hell because they're forgiven. You're going to live forever with him in heaven. And until you get there, he's committed to taking care of you, no matter how rough things get. That's astounding good news. But what makes it really astounding is this. To be able to deliver that good news, it cost God a lot. He had to send his son down from heaven into your broken world, into our frail flesh. He had to send him all the way to a cross and nail him there. Above all, pinning on his son the verdict you and I deserve. The waywardness of the simple will kill them. For all you, your simple-minded, senseless, foolish sin, Jesus Christ suffered and died and then rose again. That's why you can be sure the good news is true, that God loves you with an unfailing love, and your sins are really all forgiven, and he's going to be your friend and your ally and not your enemy, and he's going to take you one day to the glory. That's the heart of what he wants to share with you in the wisdom of his word. But there is more. For everything you struggle with, whatever you're going through as a teenager, as someone who just got married, as someone who just retired, as someone who's in the last years of their life, if you're struggling with a powerful temptation, if you've got work issues, whatever is going on, he wants to share with you direction, comfort, and guidance in your word, in his word, because he loves you. And he wants to help you as your friend and your savior. Knowing this is the kind of God we have through the wisdom of his word makes all the difference in how we respond to wisdom's invitation, doesn't it? How can I possibly say with arrogance and self-righteousness, all right, I've heard this all. I don't need to hear it again. I got it. I've been hearing this since I was a kid. And if there's still room for improvement in living a life of wisdom, like Paul encouraged us to do in our epistle lesson, what would lead me to say, maybe later I'll be devoted to the word. Maybe later I'll take up wisdom's invitation. When we know who our God is, it is a no-brainer. Why would I turn up a feast of wisdom from God, so graciously offered to a sinner like me? Sarah doesn't pass up those feasts. Sarah is one of the participants in the Bible study we do at the Ingham County Assisted Living Center behind Kroger's. Sarah was in Bible class again Wednesday, lifelong Christian, 102 years old. Let's see, she's been hearing the Word of God since 1913. What is she doing going to Bible class? Doesn't she know it yet? And at 102 years old, I mean, if you're going to be mature in the faith, I would kind of think it would be at that age, wouldn't it? So what do you think she's doing there? I think Sarah would tell you she still needs to hear about her sin, and she still needs to be assured of her Savior's forgiveness. I think Sarah would tell you at 102, she's got the same problems she had at 22 or at 52. Because she's still living in a sinful world and life still is rough. And she needs the comfort, strength, and guidance of God's word. By her actions, she shows she agrees with wisdom. Who says in Proverbs 8, verse 34, blessed is the man who listens to me, watching daily at my doors, waiting at my doorway. We have three key initiatives in our church for this year. Remember what they are? We want to encourage God's people to sing.
simply hear God's word regularly in worship. Participate in a Bible class when we grow in our faith with our fellow believers and in relationships with them, so that we can be equipped to share the wisdom of God's word with the human race outside these walls still living in ignorance and unbelief, and will perish apart from Jesus Christ. I can put that off. I can put something else ahead of it. Not when I know who my God is and how valuable my wisdom is to me. Not when, like Sarah, I recognize how blessed I am when I cling to that word and take full advantage of every opportunity. So when wisdom comes calling, when you have the opportunity to grow in your faith in any way, reading the word at home or here at church, teaching it to your kids, respond the right way. By faith in Jesus, say, I know this message, this invitation is for me. And I appreciate what God in his wisdom has to share with you. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God which transcends understanding will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please remain standing and we'll sing our response to God's word, which is hymn 181, stanzas 1. Christ.
Give us wisdom and a right knowledge of your word, so that we will not be led astray by the false ideas of this world or by our own deceitful thinking.
Help us to build each other up in the true faith as we admonish, encourage, comfort, and teach other God's word.
In a world that is offended at Christ, who is the only Savior of the world, and that despises your word as the only source of true and saving wisdom, help us not to be ashamed of Jesus and his gospel.
But use us to extend your invitation to find lasting truth and saving grace in Jesus Christ to all people.
Holy Spirit, empower and equip pastors, teachers, missionaries, and other church workers to speak the truth in love.
And keep those who hear them from rejecting your word, empowering them to hear it through repentance, and to be made wise for salvation through faith in Jesus.
Bless President Obama, Governor Snyder, and all those who hold offices of public trust in our land, that they serve according to the will of God and for the good of all people.
Help all in law enforcement and those who judge in our courts to act in true justice for the benefit of those they serve.
For those who are sick and dying, those who suffer from depression, and those in any affliction, including Jackie Korak and Dave Russ, who will be undergoing serious surgery this week, that they may have patience and peace while they await surgery, and the blessing of successful surgery according to your gracious will. And for the grieving families of Edna Janetsky and Rosetta Peterman, the mother of Rainey Andrews, we ask for your comfort. And a risen Savior who promises to be with us in our grief, to comfort us with the certainty of his grace and the promise of eternal life. Give to all of them strength to trust that the wisdom of God that sent his Son to a cross to pay for their sins will not allow trouble in the lives of his people without using it for good, so that they join with us in praying with confidence.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation. And bestow on us your saving peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. of all, our open house Sunday is fast approaching. That's Sunday, September 13th. We'll have our annual potluck and also fun outside in the churchyard, so please plan on bringing a dish to pass. Main drinks and drinks will be provided. We're also seeking donations for the prize tent for the kids as a result of the games they'll play. See your bulletin for more information on all of this. We'll also need some help that day with food prep and also with setup and takedown, so give me help with that. Can you let Amy know or sign up on the bulletin board, volunteer sheet, you can help out with that. Next Sunday, there will be a Sunday school teachers and coordinator meeting, and that will be between the services at 9:50 a.m. in the kitchen area. So older Sunday school kids, you're going to be meeting in Pastor Culbert's office on next Sunday for your class. So we'll just switch that around for that particular Sunday. In your bulletin, there is information on the full menu of Bible classes starting this fall. There's four of them. So you have an opportunity Sunday morning, also Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday morning, to grow in your faith through God's Word. So I hope that inspired by the Word of God today, you will really seriously consider making use of these classes. People who regularly attend Bible class will tell you it leaves an imprint on their lives that week in a lot of ways, in marriage and family life, and how you go through work struggles, and the kinds of things you're prepared to say to people who maybe don't know Jesus to share your faith with them. So it's a great blessing to be able to study the Word of God with fellow believers like that. And I would encourage you not only to do that, but also to daily read and study God's Word. If you've got a Bible, you can do that, right? Or if you want to make it really easy, you can go onto the Wells website and sign up for their daily devotion, so you'll get them in your email box. And I want to do just this for you this morning. I want to encourage you, if you haven't ever done that, just to try it. Try it for 30 days. Read the devotion. Pray that God uses this to have an impact on you that day. And see if God doesn't keep his promises to bless you through the Word. Any other announcements? Thank you.